morning, boss.
Good morning, Dutroux. Have you seen Julie?
Well, she's having a problem with Mr. Austin's fantasy.
Ah, yes, as I recall, Mr. Austin's fantasy was to become invisible. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Boss, is it possible to have half a fantasy?
What do you mean? I suppose that is Mr. Austin.
Yes, it would appear Julie is having a little problem.
Half a problem.
Half. Everyone, smiles.
Boss, who's that lady?
She is Miss Amanda Parsons from Baltimore, Maryland. Miss Parsons earns her living as a secretary, but it is an ambition to become an expert in the occult.
A pretty lady like that wants to chase after a ghost?
Yes, that's true. It is Miss Parsons' fantasy to attempt to win a $100,000 prize by staying just 2 hours in Blackmore Manor.
But, boss, nobody was able to do that and live through it.
I wrote her such a stern warning that my conscience is clear.
That man, boss.
Yes?
There is something about him. What is it?
You are most perceptive, Tatu. That is Mr. Harry Bodine. Mr. Bodine is what was once called a bounty hunter. For the reward money, he tracks down and captures the most deadly and most wanted criminals and fugitives from justice. Mr. Bodine's fantasy is to capture the only man who has ever eluded him. My dear guests, I am Mr. Rourke, your host. Welcome to Fantasy Island. Miss Parsons. May I introduce Professor Valentine?
How do you do?
And Dr. Daniels.
Yes, I know the gentlemen by reputation. They're both distinguished experts in the occult. Therefore, I imagine we're all here for the same purpose.
Yes, that is quite true.
What's happening here, Mr. Rourke?
It's very simple. All three of you have asked for the same fantasy. This is a picture of Blackmore Manor itself.
Excuse me, Jim. Mr. Rourke.
Yes, Miss Parsons.
This isn't easy for me, but I'm pleading with you. Dr. Daniels and Professor Ballantyne are already at the top of their field. But this may be the only chance I ever have to get my foot in the door to be somebody. Won't you please send them away?
Miss Parsons, I sympathize with your personal problem, but I can't play favorites among fantasizers. I couldn't possibly do what you ask. I'm terribly sorry. I imagine you all know the history of Blackmore Manor. It was purchased on the Welsh coast by an eccentric millionaire and then transported here to Fantasy Island, where it was precisely reconstructed, stone by stone, literally. Then,
The first night he tried to stay there, a ghost appeared.
But apparently it was like some diabolic form, torn straight from the bowels of hell. When the owner was released from the sanitarium, he sent me a check for $100,000 to be given to anyone who could live through at least 2 hours in Blackmore Manor. Many have tried, as you can well imagine, but no one has gained the prize. They have all been terrified.
Well, thank you for the warning, Mr. Rourke, but I have no intention of backing out.
The lady speaks for me as well.
Very well, then. There are three of you.
Therefore, Professor Valentine and Dr. Daniels will go first. Then Miss Parsons will try.
I'll have transportation ready to pick you up and take you all to Blackmore Manor in precisely 1 hour. Will you excuse me?
You will note on this map that the island to which I am sending you is the most remote one of this archipelago.
I will provide you with a small boat and, well, the rest is up to you.
Are you trying to tell me that Nick Tanner's on that island, Mr. Roy?
The boss is just saying that you should do your own dirty work yourself.
I take it you don't like my line of work, Tattoo.
For the record, Tattoo, Tanner was leader of a gang in a $500,000 bank robbery 6 months ago. Two innocent bystanders were killed in the getaway.
That's correct. I almost caught Tanner down in Georgia, but he's knows more tricks than a swamp fox. He got away from me.
You mean to say that if you catch him, the reward goes to you?
Yes, there is a reward, Tattoo, but it'll go to the families of the people he killed. This is now a matter of professional pride.
I see.
I'm ready, Mr. Roy.
Very well, Mr. Bodine. You will find your Mr. Tanner is on that island. Tattoo will take you to your boat now. It will be all right, Atul. I promise you.
It's a gloomy pile of rocks, Mr. Rourke.
Yes, it has been called that by certain people, Mr. Ross. You stand before Blackmore Manor. This is your last chance to change your mind. Very well, then. Tattoo and the driver will stay here in case any of you wisely decide to return to the hotel.
Do you have a key?
What for? We keep doors locked to keep people out. Nobody in his right mind wants to go in there. An idea. Why don't we go back to the hotel and have a cool drink? We can stay here all day. You know nothing's gonna happen.
Monstrous! Horrible!
You cannot go in there now.
Oh, yes, I can. It's all mine now. I'll be okay.
Thank you.
Stay real still, mister. You may not be the man I want, so don't make me kill you.
Harry Bodine. Somehow I didn't expect you. How'd you find me?
It was the bacon, Nick. Smell carries a long way.
Across 5,000 miles of ocean?
About it. Stand up real slow. Throw that knife down. Good, Nick, I'll give you that. But not good enough.
It's a long way back to civilization, friend. I promise you that.
I'm not your friend, but I'll cauterize that arm for you so as you don't lose it.
You wouldn't hurt me now, would you, Harry?
Oh, it might hurt a little bit. But just think, Nick, it'll strengthen your character.
Black, Admiral of the Blue. Captain Fitzhugh Ross. He looks familiar.
All this fuss and trouble just to track down an innocent man.
Yeah, an innocent man. Yeah. Well, here's about a half million reasons you're not innocent, Nick.
Oh, that's the bank's money, all right, Harry. All I'm saying is I didn't take it. Bad luck must be riding on my shoulder. I only landed on this island this morning because that rubber boat I stole was leaking bad.
Yeah. I saw it. Well, just let that be a lesson to you, Nick. Crime doesn't pay. All right, on your feet.
I'll just sit here, I think.
And when we get back to the boat, I'm gonna hogtie you.
If we get there, Harry. bet you the $500,000 we don't.
I'm not a betting man, Nicky. Now, you get over there and you sit down while I pack this stuff. And don't you even blink an eyelash.
Kill me.
Kill you? You're already a ghost.
Indeed, he is, Miss Parsons. Will you please get up, Captain? No. We can handle this discussion much, much better if you'll materialize, Captain. That's better. Miss Parsons, may I present Captain Timothy Black, late of His Majesty King George III's Royal Grenadiers.
Enchanted, Miss Parsons.
You're the ghost of Blackmore Manor?
Unfortunately, he is condemned to endlessly wander these desolate rooms to atone for a transgression of youth.
Would you mind just putting that pistol down, please?
Mr. Rourke, what's happening here?
Well, would you care to explain, Captain?
No, I've lived with the cursed memory every day for the last 250 years.
Very well, then. Captain Black was the son of the distinguished Admiral Lord Rupert Black, one of the great heroes of the British Empire. Unfortunately...
Go ahead, say it. I was as much a coward as he was a hero.
No, Captain, you're much too hard on yourself, no. His problem stems from an unfortunate affair of honor over the affections of a young lady.
He was challenged to a duel by Captain Fitzhugh Ross, a noted crackshot and expert duelist. They met in the woods with his hero father watching. When he stared down the deadly barrel of his opponent's pistol, Captain Black's nerve failed him.
No, don't shoot. Please, don't kill me!
He fled the field of honor, with his father shouting a curse after him for bringing disgrace on the family name.
Tragically, on his way back to this very room 250 years ago, the captain was thrown from his horse and killed.
Sounds nothing. I think we got company.
What kind of company, Nick?
It might be the guys I took the money from. Jack Slater and his pals.
Take cover!
Thank you.
Maybe we're in luck. Somebody might help us. Anybody here? Hello? Anybody home?
Hold it. Real still now. Both of you. That's right. Give me your guns. The other one.
Wait till the news services hear about this.
Now inside, both of you.
I was condemned to haunt this place until I could do an act of courage that would redeem me in my father's eyes. I couldn't help running from Fitzhugh Ross. He had the neighboring estate. He terrified me from the time that I was a little boy. He took my girls, my ponies. He beat me up. He broke my nose 3 times. I never learned to face up to him.
Well, Miss Parsons, it would seem that your fantasy is over. And completely successful. You have won the prize by staying the required time in Blackmore Manor.
Yes, I suppose I've gotten everything I wanted, but I do feel sort of sorry for him.
Mr. Rourke.
Yes?
There's that jogger again. He looks just like that painting of Captain Ross.
It's Captain Fitzhugh Ross. He's after me again.
Oh, no. No, Captain, no. Oh, his name is Ross, but he's only one of our guests. Although I do understand that his ancestors came from Wales. Not far from the original site of Blackmore Manor, as a matter of fact. Yes. Miss Parsons, are you ready for me to drive you to your bungalow?
Mr. Rourke, isn't that man being here rather a large coincidence?
Are you suggesting that I arranged a way for you to possibly solve Captain Black's eternal problem?
That's exactly what I'm suggesting.
Oh. Well, I see your reasoning, but of course you are wrong to suspect me. Even if it would make the best possible ending for that book you mentioned writing, the stuff of which bestsellers are made. Yes. However, it wasn't part of your fantasy to help the ghost, was it?
I am going to help you, Timothy.
To do what?
To, well, I don't know, redeem yourself with some act of courage against that man outside.
Captain Ross? Are you crazy? Aren't you satisfied with what he did to me the last time?
Timothy, don't you see? If you're already dead, how can he hurt you anymore?
Well, how can you be sure?
Trust me.
You seem to be who you say you are, Mr. Bodine. I'm Juliet Milburn. I own and run this plantation, such as it is. Is there really $500,000 in there?
You and me could go a long way on that. You hand me that shotgun and your husband didn't object too much.
My husband's dead, and I wouldn't go around the table with you. I can help stop that bleeding.
Ow!
Hold still.
You said you cauterized it back there in the jungle.
It looks like a bullet nicked an artery.
I'm lucky I didn't bleed to death.
Well, if you don't shut up and hold still, you still might.
Is it gonna hurt?
You men are all so stoic. It's going to hurt, but you'll live. Would you help me hold him down?
My pleasure. I'm sorry. I didn't know you were here alone.
3 years ago, my husband and I bought this land to raise taro and rice and be independent. A year later, he was killed in an accident. I grew up on the wrong side of Chicago, Mr. Bodine. I had to fight for everything I wanted to get and wanted to keep, including myself. I keep looking out the window. Are you expecting someone?
4 men. The rest of his gang, Mrs. Milburn. He double-crossed them. Now they're looking for him and the money. They'll trail us here sooner or later.
4 of them and 3 of us. Those are better odds than I'm used to.
2 of us, Mrs. Milburn. I wouldn't trust Nicky Boy here with a squirt gun.
The only thing in this world you do trust is money, right, Harry? Reward money. Whether the man you track down is innocent or guilty is no concern of yours, right?
Are you saying that you weren't involved in this robbery?
That's right. I ran with a gang once, but I paid my dues in prison. When I got out, I broke with Slater. He didn't like that, so he set me up to take a fall. When they knocked over that bank, they all wore masks and just left an old wallet of mine on the floor.
Mm-hmm. Then they just looked you up and handed over the money.
Wrong. I looked them up and took the money. I figured I had it coming, seeing how I got the credit.
Well, you don't believe that fairy tale, do you?
I haven't made up my mind yet.
I don't understand how anybody's father could condemn his own son like yours did. You must have hated him.
No, I didn't hate him. I didn't hate him at all. It's just, as a matter of fact, I really loved the old butcher. He just did the things that people did in those days, and, well, most of the time, he was actually awfully good to me.
Would you like to see him again?
Yes. Yes, I sure would. Just once, I would love to have him look at me and say, "Son, I'm proud of you." That would really be something.
And we're going to make it happen. Come on.
Wait, Amanda. Amanda. May I kiss you?
Kiss me?
Well, I haven't kissed a girl since the French Revolution.
Sure.
Well. That was even better than I remembered. Or maybe it's just you, but I think, well, at another time, I could fall in love with you.
Oh, that would be wonderful, but a girl 25 and a man 250, that's a real generation gap. Anyway, well, I got a plan. And the first thing we gotta do is get you some different clothes. Come on.
I've been wondering, Harry. Why don't you just hand me and the money over to Slater?
You'll get your day in court, Nick. That I promise you.
You know, Harry, sometimes I almost like you. But those guys know their way around. They're a small army, and they want that money bad.
That's what I'm counting on. Men who want money that badly aren't looking for ways to die before they can spend it.
Money. Sometimes I think that's the only thing all men ever talk or dream about.
Woo-wee!
You'll have to excuse his manners, Mrs. Milburn. You look beautiful.
Why, thank you, Mr. Bodine. Now, I see no reason why we shouldn't all go in and have dinner. I've got stew that's been on the stove cooking for six 6 hours. If you'll excuse me, I'll just go in and start setting the table.
That's a real woman there, Harry.
A lonely woman. And a lonely woman is more prone to make mistakes about her judgment in people.
What I told her about the robbery, it's the truth, Harry. I swear it.
No, those people. Wait a minute. Are you sure we're dressed all right? I mean, look at me. I look so pale. I feel just a little bit naked without my wig on.
You look wonderful. And of course you're pale. You haven't been in the sun for 250 years.
Well, I know, but...
Oh, that's all right. That's a bit just these days.
Yeah, but in my time, a couple never wore that little even on their wedding night. I mean, that's what I heard anyway.
Look, there he is now.
Oh, Captain Ross?
No. Now, look, just walk up to him and challenge him to a fight. Let him know you can really stand up to him.
No, I can't.
Maybe that'll be enough to remove the curse.
Well, all right, well, if you say so. Sir, you are a blackguard and a scoundrel.
Are you talking to me?
Go on.
Yes. You're also a pony thief. And worst of all, you're a creature totally devoid of honor.
Do you know what he's talking about? I mean, none of you is married to him or anything.
What?
Defend yourself!
Oh!
You better cool off, fella, before you get hurt.
Oh, Timothy! Timothy! Oh, Timothy, are you all right?
I think he broke my nose again.
Oh.
He was always laughing at me when we were boys, too. Amanda, we've done it your way. At least now I have the courage to do it my way. The old way. At least now I know what I have to do. To die with honor.
Like real Chicago cooking.
Thank you. How do you know about Chicago cooking?
Well, not that it matters, but I grew up on the wrong side of that town, too. But that'd be good cooking in any town.
Get out!
That's what I was afraid of. It's them. For now, you reload the weapons as ammo in my backpack.
What about me, Harry?
Take the shotgun, cover my back.
Tanner, let's talk.
I'm listening, Slater.
All we want's the money. Bring it out and you can walk away.
Do you still think I was involved in that robbery? I'll do it on one condition, Slater. Write out on a piece of paper the truth about that bank robbery.
What do you want me to say?
The truth. Was I in on that job in any way?
No, you weren't.
Then write it down. Spell it out how you set me up.
Okay, I'll do it like you say. I'll yell when I'm finished.
I just want you to know that I'd already made up my mind. I believe you.
I know. How about you, Harry?
I gave you the shotgun, didn't I?
If he goes out there, he'll be killed, won't he?
Just as soon as they have the money. We've got to think of a new game plan, and none of us leave here alive.
Please, Timothy, give me a chance to think of something else. People just don't duel anymore.
I'm sorry, Amanda. Pistols are the only language Captain Fitzhugh Ross understands.
But he's not Captain Fitzhugh Ross. He's just some distant descendant. He doesn't even know what this is all about.
Ha! Fooled you too, has he?
Oh, it's you again. And what are we dressed for today?
Let's not waste time with words, Captain. Here, use your weapon.
Now, what's going on here? This is a real gun.
Oh, Timothy, please.
What is this loony trying to do, lady?
I'm afraid he's going to kill you if he can.
Correct. Now we'll fight by the usual rules. 10 paces, turn, and then fire. 1, 2,
Timothy.
3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
He's really going to do it.
Defend yourself, sir.
No, don't shoot. Please don't kill me.
I should have known. I was a coward until the very end. I might have lifted the curse if I'd have just had the courage to shoot him.
We got a choice, Nick. Tell him to stick it, stay in here and take our chances, or we'll go out together, shooting.
Either way, it's no good for her.
I know.
Wait a minute. I just remembered something. I think it's the edge that we are going to need.
She put the dynamite caps in with the sticks.
Lucky for us, Nick. I got an idea. It's not a very good one, but if we time it right, it could work. Hold this. That ought to give you 15 seconds.
To do what?
Slater and his boys a little surprise whenever you take this money out to them.
What the devil are you gonna be doing?
Countdown, Nicky.
I guess I've just ruined things for good this time.
Oh, Timothy, listen to me. It doesn't take courage to shoot someone down in cold blood. In your case, it took a lot more courage not to. Don't you see that?
She's right, Captain Black. Shooting him would have been the most cowardly act possible. In fact, Captain, by not shooting him, and by that act possibly condemning yourself to endless years more in this manner, is undoubtedly the bravest thing you or any other man could have done.
Really think so, Mr. Rourke?
Yes, I do.
But I wonder what my father would say.
Why don't you ask him, Captain?
You've shown the greatest courage of all, my son. I'm proud of you.
Proudly. So the curse is lifted. I can leave now.
Yes, my son. The curse is lifted forever.
Amanda, if only we'd lived in the same time, I wouldn't want to go. I mean, to stay here with you, even with a curse, would have been a blessing. You understand?
Yes, Timothy, I understand.
Thank you. And thank you, Mr. Rourke. Thank you for everything.
Bye, Timothy. Well, guess my fantasy really is over now.
Wrote it down just like you said, Tanner. Bring out the money.
When you hear me yell, you get the hell back through that front door fast. 15.
Here it is. Tanner, an innocent man. Fair trade, right?
$500,000 in cold cash later. Nine, come and get it.
7, 6.
Better all be there.
Four, count it for yourself.
3, 1.
Now, Nick!
Nick, are you all right?
Yeah.
Well, looks like they'll live to stand trial. Why don't you pick up the money while I go tie him up? Thank you. Be most grateful.
What's going to happen to Nick, Mr. Bodine?
Well, looks to me like he's going to be busy patching up his front yard for a while. But I'll put in a good word for him when I get back home.
I don't know how you'll manage to do much of anything till that arm gets well.
Well, I'll think of something.
Milburn, take this man to be your lawfully wedded husband?
I do.
And do you, Nicholas Tanner, take this woman to be your lawfully wedded wife?
I do.
Then, by the power vested in me as Chief Magistrate of Fantasy Island, I now pronounce you man and wife. Well, Mr. Bodine, your friend, Mr. Tanner, got the bride. But you are the best man.
And I always will be, Mr. Orr. Well, just look at Nick. He got a life sentence after all.
Yes, indeed. And I have a feeling he's going to enjoy every second of it.
Thank you.
Welcome. Miss Parsons, we have something for you. A check for $100,000.
Oh, thank you.
For spending the necessary time in Blackmore Manor.
That's right. Oh, that reminds me, Miss Parsons, you will have a companion on your flight home.
Timothy!
Yes, you see, his father really did love him. And since his curse deprived his son of his youth, the Admiral asked me to make up for it by letting Timothy live out a normal life, hopefully falling in love and marrying. Oh, he doesn't remember he was ever a ghost. Oh, no. Mr. Black, will you? Mr. Black, may I introduce Miss Amanda Parsons?
How do you do? It's nice to meet you.
Miss Parsons is an expert in the occult.
Really, that sounds like a very interesting field.
It is. You meet some of the most beautiful people in it. Oh, thank you very much.
You're very welcome, Miss Parsons.
Thank you, Tatsu.
Goodbye.
Come on.
That was nice, boss.
Yes.